Welcome back. In this episode, we shall explore some variants of the problem of diffusion of heat. So far, we have studied the diffusion of heat in a rod that had its ends submerged in iced water, so as to fix its temperature to be 0 degrees centigrade. These were homogeneous boundary conditions. In this episode, we shall see how to relax these conditions. In addition to that, we shall see how to insulate the ends of the rod. All this is gathered under the umbrella title, a variety of boundary conditions. Enjoy.
Our next topic is a continuation of consideration of heat conduction problems. This actually concerns solutions for the heat equation, so the diffusion equation, with different types of boundary conditions. So we will consider non-homogeneous conditions, so prescribing a temperature at both ends of a rod, say, but to non-zero values, how to do that, and we shall have an example. We shall also look into what is called Neumann boundary conditions. Those correspond to insulated ends, so pack also the ends of a rod in foam so as to block any heat flow from the ends of the rods to the outside world. We shall discuss how to do that. And then finally, a brief remark on more general problems, but the details of that rather belong to chapter 11, so when we will cover Sturm-Liouville problems, we will meet those again, but I will briefly mention them just as a prospect and to name the name of that, which is Robin conditions. So it's a bit of different subjects with detail, so that may require quite some concentration and patience. So if I may suggest, perhaps watch this episode in steps and take breaks in between the different subjects. So, but because otherwise it might be a little bit of a long stretch if you see this for the first time. But now let's proceed. So the first thing that we will look into is the situation in which, again, we have a conducting rod of length L, as we are familiar with by now. But now we describe, instead of zero temperature at both ends, which were the homogeneous boundary conditions, we prescribe some non-zero temperatures. First, the naming of that, these type of conditions in which you prescribe the value of the unknown variable, the dependent variable U in this case, at the boundaries of the domain, those type of conditions are known as Dirichlet conditions. And that is what we will have here, so prescribing the values at the boundaries. And if the temperatures that are prescribed in that way would both be zero, then we talk about homogeneous Dirichlet conditions. And as we saw so far, those are very profitable because they directly appeal to the superposition principle. So homogeneous Dirichlet conditions play a central role in the theory. But here we have non-homogeneous boundary conditions, and later on we will see Neumann boundary conditions, in which, as opposed to here, we prescribe the values of the function. In Neumann conditions, you put the boundary condition on the derivatives of the function. But we will see that later in this episode. And then there's also Robin boundary conditions that prescribes a linear combination between the value and and the derivative of the function at the boundaries. And what that means, we will see here at the end of this episode. Well, so here we have them in the non-homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions, and how to approach this, how to solve such a problem. Well, that is a kind of a mathematical, more general strategy. If you have a new problem, you might typically try to reduce it somehow to a problem that you already can solve. And in our case, that we can solve this problem if the conditions are homogeneous. So if T1 and T2 would be zero, then we already have the solution. So to say, we know how to do that, and we already have it in our toolkit. So once we could decompose this problem into a homogeneous problem and an additional problem, the homogeneous part we can solve straightforwardly. And how to do that is inspired by a physical argument, you might see. It is also deeply inspired by linearity again, as follows. So, you might say, I'm going to decompose the solution for the non-homogeneous boundary value problem into two parts. One of those solutions I anticipate gets the task to take care of the boundary conditions, so the T1 and the T2. The other part, I would like to be a problem that is a problem that I can already solve, so that I'd like that to be a problem of the homogeneous I like that to be a homogeneous boundary value problem. And if I decompose a solution, so I conceive it as this being the sum of two problems, then I can take profit from the fact that differential equation here is linear. That means if I would substitute two solutions into that differential equation, then I can get a solution of the differential equation at least. And then the idea is to split that into one problem that takes part of the boundary conditions. And for that we take a kind of a simple solution of this differential equation, and that would be a stationary solution. So, and the existence of that is inspired by physics. And the idea is, if you would wait a long time and let the heat adjust itself to the situation, so that you get a situation that is fully adjusted and comes in equilibrium, so it would no longer depend on time. And that's called a stationary state. So then you get a solution of the differential equation that no longer depends on t. And if you would substitute that in the differential equation, the t derivative actually would become zero. So that part of the solution would actually obey an ordinary differential equation, which would be just this left-hand side, and the right-hand side would be replaced by zero. So then we have part of the solution that we anticipate will satisfy a simpler differential equation, and now we take the initiative that we will have that part, that simpler, the part of the solution that satisfies a simpler differential equation, we will organize things such that that solution will take care of the boundary conditions. And then the other part that we will add, that also will have to satisfy the differential equation, so that the superposition is a solution of the differential equation, that part that no longer has to take care of the boundary conditions. So that will satisfy the homogeneous problem, and that we can already solve. See? So from physics we anticipate that there will exist a stationary solution that satisfies a simpler differential equation, and then we make the choice that we use that to take the boundary conditions into account. And the other part of the solution that should be used to fully satisfy the differential equation also as a function of time, then no longer has to take the boundary conditions into account. So that will satisfy a homogeneous problem, and that we can already solve. So that is the idea. And that is what is outlined in this slide also. So after a long time we anticipate that there will be a steady state solution that no longer depends on time. So that will satisfy this equation, the double derivative with respect to x. So if it is only a function of x, it will be the double prime of that function should be zero. And that is actually a very simple thing that just says the curvature of a function must be zero, so that must be something like a straight line, and it has to start at the beginning of the rod at temperature 1 and ends at temperature 2, and then we can immediately write down an expression for that. It should be a straight line starting at T1, ending at T2. Over a length of L, and the solution is then this. Well, it's a straight line that satisfies those boundary conditions. And then here in the top green box is the initiative, as I just described it in words, but here we have it in a formula form. So we anticipate that the full solution of the differential equation on this one satisfies both the diffusion equation and the boundary conditions is conceived as being decomposed linearly as a part as we just developed it, that is stationary and takes care of the boundary conditions, plus another equation that we then expect to satisfy a homogeneous boundary value problem. Now, in either case, if we require this W function to be a solution of the diffusion equation, the heat equation, and this, as we saw, is a solution of the heat equation, then both are solutions of the heat equation, and the linear combination of them, U, will also be a solution of the heat equation. So that is fine. Now, in a previous slide, we already solved this stationary solution, satisfying the boundary condition. And now the question is, what is the full problem, including boundary conditions for W of X? And I already anticipate that that will be a homogeneous boundary value problem. But let's check once more, just to be sure. So, this bullet over here says if we would substitute, as I said, this U into the heat equation, this one satisfies the heat equation, so that it cancels out, and what remains is the requirement that W also satisfies the heat equation, that is what I just discussed. And now for the boundary value requirements for that W. Now, what should the value of W be for X is 0 for all T? Now, by definition, W is equal to U minus V, as in the top green box. So if we substitute X is 0, we get U at 0 for all T minus V at 0 for all T. Now, this we know because that is the prescribed boundary condition for U in the first place, as in this problem, that what should be T1, and V1 is constructed such as that it satisfies the condition T1 at zero. That was the idea to have V take care of that boundary condition, and that is exactly this statement. V takes care of the boundary condition at zero, so that takes care of the T1 that U is required to be according to the full specification of the non-homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions. And so the difference is zero, so the as I anticipated, the boundary condition to this W function to be put at zero is zero. And likewise for L, the value for W at axis L according to this definition is U minus V at L. Now, this is again the prescribed temperature at the end of the rod according to the prescribed boundary conditions for it, that is T2, and V at L is also T2 because we agreed that V would take care of the boundary conditions. So again the difference is zero, and we see that indeed, as planned, W obeys homogeneous boundary conditions. So now we can already decide that we will be able to solve the differential equation, that is the very safe diffusion equation for W, because the W satisfies homogeneous boundary conditions, and that is what we have been working on in the previous episodes. So we know the solution. The question only is what exactly are now the initial conditions to be put on that W? Well, once again, what is initial value specification occurs at T is zero. Now, according to the definition in this green box, W is U minus V, so we put that here, substituting T is zero, and that should be here, the second argument of U. Now, in these both quantities we know, because this U, this is the initial condition that has been specified on the function U by our original boundary value problem. That is the initial condition on U, that was what we used to call for f of x, and that is the temperature distribution at T is zero, and we still call that f of x. So here it is, f of x, and v of x, v doesn't depend on T. That is a stationary state, so the value for V of x at T0 is just V of x. So we see that the boundary condition for this correction function, the time-dependent correction function W, is equal to the initial condition on U minus our stationary state function V. And these together provide homogeneous boundary conditions for W and a modified but known initial condition for W at T is zero, together with just the same diffusion equation as we have been working on until now. So in principle we know the solution for this W, and that solves the problem for U for the non-homogeneous Dirichlet problem as well. And that is summarized on this slide. So here is a summary of what the homogeneous boundary value problem for W looks like. It looks like what we were used to for homogeneous heat boundary value heat equations, except that the initial condition for the W function is the initial condition for the original U minus the stationary state. And the stationary state solution is a straight line with the appropriate appropriate temperatures at the beginning and the end of the rod. And that is this expression over here. Yeah, and furthermore, because this is just a homogeneous boundary value heat problem, the solution is the same as in the previous episode. So again, we have a sine series with sine functions being zero at the beginning and the end of the rod, and their amplitudes are decaying exponential functions of time. And once again, we can use the projection formula to calculate the coefficients of this series, so the Cn, using the inner product again, so multiplying the initial value specification for the function w, and that is this one. So f of x, that is the arbitrary initial temperature distribution to be specified as a initial value for u, minus the stationary state, that is this v function, and that is substituted in full detail here in this expression. And that integral would give you the coefficients of that series. So once again, we split the full solution for u into a function v that is stationary, so that it satisfies a simpler differential equation, but that then can take care of the boundary values, and another function that takes care of the time dependence, so that satisfies a more complicated differential equation, but it satisfies a simpler boundary value problem, namely those, the boundary conditions for that are homogeneous. So you divide the difficulties over those two contributions to the solution, and it can be done once again because the diffusion equation is a linear equation. So if you substitute two solutions, the sum of two solutions, then you get another solution. And all that is summarized again on this slide. So we substitute the sum, making use of the linearity of the equation for u, and divide the difficulties. So the more difficult boundary conditions are applied to v, and the time dependence is taken care of by w, but that then satisfies homogeneous boundary conditions, so that is then simpler in that sense. So that's a smart idea, and again based on the linearity. This plus is the superposition. That can be done because this equation is linear. Now let's have an example of that quick. So we have a rod again, and this time it has a length 30. And here's a non-homogeneous boundary condition, so the temperature at the beginning of the rod at all times larger than zero is kept constant to be 20 degrees, and the end of the rod is 50 degrees over here. And at T is zero, the initial condition for the temperature is 60 minus 2x. So that would be 60 at the beginning of the rod, as compared to 20 that it is for T larger than zero. So immediately after the T is zero, the temperature has dropped by 40 degrees from 60 to 20. And at the end of the rod for x is 30, in the limit to x for x to 30, the temperature apparently is zero, 60 minus 60. But initially and immediately after that, it is 50. So that's interesting. And once again, it's a remark that I made before. does not need to be a continuity in the at that point x is zero and t is zero. If you approach it from different sides, those limits might differ, so there's a discontinuity there in that sense that is allowed. We will see it in a solution also. Now, a steady state solution here would satisfy, again, has to be a straight line, taking care of these boundary conditions. So that would be x plus 20. If x is 0, you get 20, and if you add 30 at the other end of the, you get this 50. So that is x plus 20 would be the stationary state of the temperature distribution in this rod, satisfying the non-homogeneous boundary conditions. And then the part W that takes care of the time dependence satisfies a homogeneous differential equation problem, so homogeneous boundary conditions at the beginning and the end of the rod, same differential equation, but the initial value is the original one, that is the 6t minus 2x minus the stationary state, so minus 20 plus x, so that is 40 minus 2x minus x is minus 3x. So this together is the initial value problem for W of x with homogeneous boundary conditions, and then for that we can apply the solution that we already had. So that looks like this again. Not this. And then the full solution for U is the stationary state, that is this, x plus 20, plus the solution for W. And that is again for the same form as we got used to in the previous episodes, that we developed in the previous episodes. And the coefficients here can be calculated by Fourier integrals again, from the initial value that is prescribed to W, so that is this 40 minus 3x that we had over here. That is substituted here. So these integrals give the Cn. Now that would be a little bit of work to work it out, so you could do that for yourself as an exercise. It's not much different from the worked out examples that we did in the, so far, and this graph gives an overview of the outcome of that. So you see indeed that at t is zero we have this blue line over here, that is the initial value, that is indeed 60 minus 2x, so when x is 30, indeed the temperature is zero at the far side of the rod, and at the beginning of the rod it is 60. And so that indeed was the initial value for the temperature U as specified by the problem that we are studying now, that's 60 minus 2x, that is this blue line over here. And then the stationary state solution for t to infinity, that is indicated by this dark dot over there, that is the stationary state x plus 20, so that starts at 20 and it ends at 50, that is this line. So that is the stationary state that the temperature will take after an infinite amount of time. And the other blue curves here is the temperature distribution that is the result of the procedure that we followed, the solution as developed after 3 and 25 seconds. So you notice this But at T is zero, the temperature is zero there, here, at the end of the rod. But immediately after that, the temperature is 50 degrees, as it should be according to the steady state solution. That is this, that 30 plus 20, that is here. And then gradually, in the course of time, the temperature distribution inside the rod adjusts more and becomes more and more like this steady state that it will take after an infinite amount of time. So that is briefly the idea of non-homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions and the inspiration and the approach how to solve that. Now, next on the agenda is what is called Neumann boundary conditions for insulated ends. What it looks like mathematically is right here in the green box. And the idea is that we now study a bar as we did so far, and the bar is certainly insulated, so packed in a foam or something along the sides of the rod, but now we also add insulation at the ends of the rod. So no heat is now allowed to escape from the ends of the rods. That means that no heat is allowed to escape anywhere from the rod. So if there is a temperature distribution in there, all the heat that is in there must stay in there. It is only allowed to redistribute itself inside that rod. And how to prescribe the boundary conditions then? Well, if we go all the way back to the beginning of these episodes about the heat conduction problem, when we thought about the physical interpretation of the diffusion equation, we said, okay, it's bookkeeping, so the amount of heat decreases because it is, there's a heat flux, a heat flow, and that heat flow was driven by temperature gradient. So it spreads out from high to low temperatures, it moves, flows from high to low temperatures. So the heat flow is proportional to the temperature gradient, and temperature here is U, so that would be the derivative of U. So the derivative of U is the driving force for the heat transport. So if the transport is to be zero, then the derivative of U must be zero, because the gradient, the derivative of U is what is driving the flux. So if there is no flux, if there is insulation and there is no flux, then the gradient apparently must be zero. And that is what we have here. We prescribe the derivative of U at the end of the bar to be zero. This is the end and at the beginning also. So at both ends, the gradient of U is now enforced to be zero. And that is the mathematical implementation of saying that it is insulated, there is no heat transport across those boundaries. So the problem looks rather similar as what we had with homogeneous Dirichlet conditions, except that now instead of the value prescribed, we have the derivatives prescribed. So, let's just try to solve it with the same approach then. So again, we look for separable fundamental solutions. And again, we would substitute those into the differential equation and separate. And we see that once again, as before, this partial differential equation falls apart in two coupled eigenvalue problems. And I used to say my notation as before. So again, we have this creative notation for the separation constant, which has a sign, so that we can that we will be very aware of the fact that the choice of the sign for that separation constant is of great consequences for what kind of eigenfunctions you get. Now, what about boundary conditions then? For what are the consequences of the Neumann boundary conditions for the eigenfunctions? Well, if we say we study the consequence of the Neumann boundary conditions for these type of functions, we take the derivative with respect to x. So that would only apply to this x of x. So that would be x prime and at zero. So it would be x prime at zero times t for all t. And that has to be zero. So this is the implementation for that Neumann boundary condition at the beginning of the rod. And it applies apparently to the derivative of capital X now. Otherwise, the reasoning is the same as before. We are interested to find non-trivial solutions, so we exclude the solution that would be zero for all t. So we exclude the possibility that t is identically equal to zero. And we look for functions that are such that their derivative is zero at zero. And similarly, this boundary condition, the Neumann boundary condition at the end of the rod, would imply that we look for functions x of x of which the derivative at the end of the rod is now zero. Now, if we confront those boundary conditions on x as listed here, so the derivative of x both at the beginning and the end of the rod should be zero. If we confront our overview of eigenfunctions of the double derivative with that, then after some reasoning you come to the conclusion that the only candidates from this overview that satisfy these boundary conditions are the cosine functions over here. Indeed, if you would look for eigenfunctions that have a positive eigenvalue, so from the top box, we look for functions that have the derivative zero. Now, that would be the hyperbolic cosine functions. Those are linear combinations of the exponential functions, so cosines, cosine, hyperbolic cosine, and the derivative of that is the hyperbolic sine. That has a zero, but it has only one zero, so that will be zero at zero. So the derivative of the hyperbolic cosine would be zero at zero, but it would be the hyperbolic sine, and that has only one zero. So it is not possible to form a linear combination out of these eigenvalues with positive eigenvalues that have a zero slope at both at the beginning and the end of the domain. So those are ruled out. Now, then if we consider the eigenvalues with negative of the eigenfunctions with negative eigenvalues from the middle box, that those will be all the linear combinations of the sines and the cosines. So the derivatives again will be linear combinations of sines and cosines. And if that has to be zero, that means the derivative has to be a sine. So the original function apparently has a cosine. And that is this one. And that can indeed be also zero. The derivative of that can indeed also be zero. So that is a sine again for x is L if omega is een integer multiple of pi over L. Because then again we have if the function is the cosine and the derivative is the sine, and the sine of an integer multiple of pi is zero. So those are candidates. And then if we move on to the lowest box here, that those are the eigenvalues with eigenfunctions with eigenvalue zero of this operation. So those are the straight lines. Now the straight lines that have slope zero are the horizontal lines, so that would be these lines, so that would be the constant functions. So that is also a candidate, but it is redundant, because if we choose zero for the integer here, you would get the cosine of zero, which is one, and that is the same function. So we decide that there are eigenfunctions of eigenvalue zero that would be candidates, but those are already included in this set. If we keep in mind that we will allow n to take the value zero this time. So that's a little difference from the homogeneous problem. When we worked with the signs, then we started with n is one, but now we will start with n is zero, use the cosine functions with this specification for the parameter omega, and that will then be a complete set of all eigenfunctions that we can identify in this table satisfying these boundary conditions. And once again we see that the set is discrete, countable, so for any value of n integer starting with 0, 1, 2, 3 we find the eigenvalue, eigenfunction, and the eigenvalues again are omega squared. And that indeed includes the case n is 0, because then the eigenvalue would indeed be 0, and then that corresponds to the fact that for n is 0 the cosine function becomes constant. So that's fine. So again we have negative eigen values as we had before, given by this expression. Now that has to be combined with the equation that we had for the time-dependent factor t in the solution. But that's the same as before. That we had the same. We get the same eigenvalues, of course, because we pick solutions from the same box, and these all have the same eigenvalues, the sines and the cosines. So the solution for the time dependence is the same as we had before. That is again this exponential function. And now combining that, so we again combine the selected eigenfunctions for x with their matched partners, so for the same eigenvalues, to form again a fundamental set of solutions for each n, each value, integer value n. 0, 1, 2, 3, we find separable solutions again of this form, and a difference between this case and what we had for the homogeneous Dirichlet problems is that we have now a cosine instead of the sine function that we had. Because now the slopes have to be 0 at the beginning at the end, and previously the values had to be 0 at the beginning of the end, and that is the difference between having a sine or a cosine here. So these solutions are separable, and they all satisfy the heat equation, the diffusion equation, and the homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions now. And once again, the heat equation is a linear differential equation. So we can again apply a superposition, make an arbitrary linear superposition of all these functions to find more general solutions of the differential equation. And those will still satisfy the homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions, because they all have the slope zero. So now we add them up, make linear superposition, and adding all those slope zero, and that will remain the slope zero. So, once again, if we take profits from the linearity of the differential equation and use superposition to form a more general solution, so we make a superposition of all the separable solutions that we have found so far, and because all these obey the homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions, so the slope of all the separable solutions are zero at the beginning and the end of the domain. Superposition implies that at the beginning and the end of the domain we add solutions that all have slope zero, and all those added zeros will remain zero, so the superimposed solution will also have slope zero at the beginning and the end of the domain, so that will also satisfy the homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions. Note once again that we form a large superposition of separable solutions, so once again we have a basis, you might say. And one difference, a detail, different from the previous case, is that now we include the value n is zero, as we discussed, because that does not vanish, that gives the constant solution in space and time. And negative values of n would not add anything independent, because here we have n squared, it doesn't make any difference anyway. And the cosine is even, so cosines of positive and negative arguments are the same. So that doesn't bring anything new. Our task that remains is to confront the solution with the initial conditions. So once again, we investigate what is the prediction of the value at t is zero. We can calculate it by substituting t is zero, and then all the exponential functions take the value one. So the solution reduces to a cosine series at t is zero, and then the temperature is just the prescribed temperature distribution once again. So the initial condition boils down to this, that the cosine series must render the prescribed temperature distribution at t is zero. And then once again we take profit from the orthogonality of the cosines in this case, as we discussed when we discussed the full Fourier series last episode. And here's the overview in the lower green box. So it is all based on the general inner product again for functions on some interval, and in this case it is the interval from 0 to L. And as we saw in the previous episode, if we remember the multiplication table, the cosines are orthogonal on this interval for integer m and n. That is, if m and n is different, then all those products are 0. If m and n are equal but non-zero, then these products are equal to half the length of that interval. And then there's this exceptional case again, when m and n are both zero, then you integrate one over the interval, and then the value of the integral is L, the length of the interval. Now the textbook once again, that exceptional case here, m is n is zero, which is exceptional in the case that the value that you get for the integral in that case is different, is taken care of in the textbook by splitting off the n is zero term. So that is exactly that exceptional case, and they redefine the c by adding this half here. And the reason for that is technical. It says, well, if we have the full initial value problem, so the specified temperature at t is zero, then with this definition that leads to u of x at zero is a copy of this expression for u of x at t with t is zero substituted, so that would then give this c 0 over 2 plus that cosine series, and that should equal the prescribed value f of x. And then for dcn, you can use these orthogonality relations with this half L is the outcome if n is not 0, so that applies to all these c's for n larger than 1 and including 1, but so larger than 0. So those are these relations. Integrate this cosine function with the prescribed initial value, integrate over the full length of the interval and divide by half the length to calculate the cn, and that directly applies to these cn. But if you do define a split off term like this with this extra half, then you can use the same relation for n is 0, because n is 0 would correspond to 1 here, and the normalization constant then would be L, that cancels against this L, and the T, the 2 over here, cancels against that extra T, so that this Cn becomes then that C0. So the distinct case M is N is 0 can be taken care of by taking this extra half. But if you find it complicated, and I personally find it a bit of a complicated workaround of things, you can always just work with defining without this half, as long as you take into account that to calculate the C0, then you have to divide by this normalization L, which is the length of this norm of the degree, which is the value of this integral for m and n both equal to 0. So as soon as you act consciously and know what you're doing, you should be fine with this. So in summary, the homogeneous Neumann value boundary value problem, heat equation, homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions and a prescribed initial temperature profile. The solution of that is given by this expression, cosine series, and this leading constant term. And if you do like this, all the coefficients can be calculated by this integral expression. And if you have a look at that, for t going to infinity, all these exponential terms have a positive but negative, non-zero negative argument here that increases with time, but negatively. So these functions all go to zero. So all the amplitudes of the cosine terms go to zero for t to infinity. And that means in the limit for t to infinity, the value, the temperature distribution will take this constant value over here. And that is physically plausible, because if you insulate the bar from all sides, then the heat that is present in the initial states just readjusts itself by spreading, and it takes a constant value at infinity, for t to infinity, and that is just the average value of the temperature as it was in the initial state. So this is the average value of the initial temperature distribution, and that is just equal to that leading term C0 over 2. So that is also the steady state for T to infinity, as this expression shows. Now there's an example here, applied to a rod of 25 centimeters. An initial temperature described by just starting at zero and linearly increasing to 25 degrees at the end of the rod. And at the end, insulated ends, so homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions at the beginning and the end of the rod. Now you recognize the general solution here with 25, the length of the rod substituted in the solution. And you might work out these integrals for yourself to calculate the coefficients to end up with this general expression for the solution. And let's have a look at what it looks like. Again, it has the character of a negative exponential decrease of the amplitudes of the cosines. So again, you have this effect of spreading out of details. And again, we have a rapid convergence, so you usually only need a few terms of such a series to get an accurate result. And again, we will have a numerical example, measure t in seconds, and alpha squared will have the units of centimeter squares per second. And again, we take a value of 1 for that alpha squared, so again, we have a material between somewhere copper and aluminum. And then a solution with homogeneous Neumann boundary condition would look like this for this initial profile. And the final state is this horizontal line. That makes sense. The heat just spread out and the total amount of heat is contained in the rod. So it takes the arbitrary value in the end of 12.5 degrees, which is halfway 25 and 0. And notice that at all times, directly after t is 0, the slope at the end is 0. And that is the Neumann, the enforced Neumann boundary condition, which does not apply yet to the initial profile. But that again, that discontinuity in the derivative again is allowed by the heat conduction problem. The diffusion equation can handle that. That is the core of the subject that we had to cover in this episode, the Dirichlet boundary conditions with prescribed values and Neumann boundary conditions which prescribes the values of the derivatives. You can think of combinations. You could, for example, prescribe the temperature at one end of the rod and insulate it at the other end of the rod. Then again, you have a non-homogeneous condition here, and the tactics for solving it would be the same as we discussed at the beginning of this episode. So you would subtract a steady state solution to reduce this boundary condition to a homogeneous one. And then the general procedure to solve such a problem is essentially the same. So you can look for separable solutions, use the boundary conditions to select suitable eigenfunctions from the table. And but it is best learned by doing some examples and practicing, I think. But the procedure in general is the same, and the concept involves are the same. A little more general still is the so-called Robin boundary condition, which I just mentioned here for completeness. And we will return to this when we cover chapter 11, the Sturm-Liouville theory. What we will see then is that we will be able to handle conditions of this type that says I do prescribe the heat flux, so that is driven by the temperature gradient, and I make that a linear function of the temperature that the rod had as the beginning and at the end of it. So it says the temperature flux is driven by the temperature is proportional. So you might say that is a kind of an imperfect isolation. That might be a really more realistic model actually than perfect insulation of a rod, of a heat conducting piece of material. And the way to model that could be this, and that is called the Robin boundary condition. But we will return to this in chapter 11. Again, we will apply separation of variables, and again, we will look into the boundary conditions to select suitable eigenfunctions. But it becomes technically a little bit more involved. We will return into that in chapter 11. Now, So in summary, in general, the method of separation of variables, in which we look for fundamental solutions that can be written as a product of a function that only depends on x, and another factor that only depends on t, that turned out to be successful for solving problems involving the diffusion equation and various types of homogeneous boundary conditions and non-homogeneous stationary conditions, so fixed temperature but non-zero at the beginning and the end of the rod, or maybe slopes, can be reduced to homogeneous ones by subtracting an easy to find stationary solution. So again, this decomposition by what I call subtraction, that is you write a full solution as a sum, as a linear superposition of two parts, and one of the parts takes care of the boundary conditions, but you take for that the stationary solution, so that is easier to find, and then the other part no longer has to take care of the boundary conditions, so that satisfies a homogeneous problem. That's easier in that sense, and that you can then use to take care of the time dependence. So that is a kind of a clever tactical move, again taking profit of the linearity of the problem. Now, in all cases, we separation of variables led to an infinite basis of functions satisfying the partial differential equation and homogeneous spatial boundary conditions, and the eigenfunctions that took care of the spatial dependence were selected. So, and all the functions in the span of that basis satisfy the partial differential equation and the homogeneous boundary conditions as a result of the fact that by the superposition involved we add zeros and zeros add up to zero. So this really the homogeneous conditions that you focus on to select suitable eigenfunctions, because then you profit from the combination of the being homogeneous and superposition, that the superposition adding up zeros to zero. Now at t is zero, the reduced basis of all the separable solutions evaluated at t is zero turned out to be an orthogonal basis. Once you have selected a suitable inner product, as we did, and that enables you to calculate coefficients of the series that you meet one by one. And in the examples that we accounted so far, that led to Fourier series. And along this way, we saw that we can deal with initial conditions, so prescribed temperature profile at T is zero. Now, in general, fundamental solutions are characterized by a product of spatial and a temporal pattern. So, x of x takes care of the spatial distribution, and it has a matched time-dependent function that describes its amplitude as a function of time. Now, this is a more general feature linear physical systems described by linear partial differential equations, and such modes are called eigenmodes. And we will meet the same kind of phenomenon again next episode, when we will concentrate on the wave mode. So we're studying a vibrating string, and we will meet this idea of the total solution being built up out of such separable building blocks once again. All right. Now, so far, this overview of how to work with the method of separation of variables in the context of a variety of boundary value problems and also inhomogeneous initial value or initial inhomogeneous boundary conditions combined with initial value problems. So that closes this initial phase of exploring partial differential equations. And given that, we may call this an episode.